Good evening. I am Dr. Srinivas here, Professor of Dermatology, and I have already recorded few talks, and in continuation with that, I thought I will discuss a very important subject which both the surgeons have to manage, vascular surgeons have to manage, and the dermatologists have to manage. Leg ulcer is a very common problem, occurs most often in the older age group, and brings down the quality of life to a very significant extent. So this classification of leg ulcer, it could be because of the venous causes, it could be arterial, it could be mixed, or the hypertensive ischemic ulcers. Most often, in many of the cases, there will be some amount of overlap of these components. Now, what's a chronic ulcer? An ulcer that has been around for about 4 to 6 weeks duration, which is rather deep, and you will find that hardly any epithelialization occurs from the periphery. So these chronic ulcers, when you see the patient, you will have to gather certain facts, not in the standard way of taking history, but we gather facts such as how old is the patient, how long the ulcer has been present, the duration. The longer the ulcer has been become, the more difficult it is to heal most often. Whether it is painful, such as hypertensive ulcers, arterial ulcers can be painful. Not that venous ulcers will be painless. They can also be painful. And if there is secondary infection, of course, the pain can be more. Is the pain more during walking or during rest? And if the patient is obese, these are the various things. And his occupation, does his occupation entails prolonged standing? Because persons who have long history of long standing, who stand continuously, in those cases we find stasis occurs much more often. And then when we examine, we look at the person to turn round when and look at the legs to see if there are dilated veins, which can be seen as tortural vessels, which we can see at the back. Is the person diabetic? Is he hypertensive? That is important part of the history. And if there is any history of injury of the leg, that also is important. And if there is history of the injury, how severe was the injury? Was it associated with fracture? Was any major surgery done or not? And if the patient is bedridden, in which case, of course, we know that deep vein thrombosis can occur in persons who are immobilized. Then, whether the ulcer has been preceded by an eczema, you can ask, was there any history of long-standing itching in that site? Was there oozing? Because often venous ulcers will often be preceded by stasis eczema. And is there any constitutional symptoms, such as if there is secondary infection, then there can be constitutional symptoms. Then if there is history of abortion, cerebrovascular accident, which can occur if there is lupus anticoagulant syndrome, about which I'm not going to discuss too much over here. And then we look up at the sides, whether it is over the medial aspect of the leg, lateral aspect of the leg, whether the dorsa is involved, whether the tip of the toes are involved, are the various things which you look at the ulcer, and whether there is granulation tissue, and if there is a granulation tissue, is it a healthy granulation tissue or an unhealthy granulation tissue, and whether deeper structures such as fossa are visible or not. Then we look at the type of the discharge. It will often tell us whether it is just oozing, means there is no great secondary infection, and if there is a pus, then we can make it out. And then many of these ulcers, especially the venous ulcers, you will find that there will be surrounding pigmentation. And if you touch with the finger, there will be often cardboard hard sort of rigidity due to lipodermatosclerosis. Arterial ulcers can be tender. Even venous ulcers can be tender if there is inflammation. And if ulcer has healed, whether there is scarring, has healed with scarring. And if there is secondary infection, of course, the lymphadenopathy, especially the inguinal lymphadenopathy, will be there. This is a classical ulcer. This is a venous ulcer, stasis ulcer, which is seen over the medial aspect of the leg. So why does this venous ulcer occur? Venous ulcers occurs because of the venous reflux, or if there is an obstruction to the flow of the blood, or if the muscle pump is not acting properly. These venous ulcers could be because of the involvement of the deep vein system, or because of the superficial veins, or because of the perforators. Of these, perforators contribute the least. The superficial one respond better to treatment, both to medical treatment as well as surgical treatment. Deep vein system ulcers are the one that are the most difficult to treat. Now we know that leg has got superficial and deep, which we just discussed. Of that, this is the diagram showing the various veins, the long saphenous, the short saphenous, the perforators. Again, the long saphenous vein. Now these veins has got a superficial, as I said, which is just below the skin and the fossa. And this is connected by perforators to the deeper veins. In areas where there is musculature, it will go through the muscles. In areas where there is not much muscle, it will directly drain into the vein. That is important because when muscles are there, muscles will contract and push the blood up the leg. So these are the various perforators and the veins which you can see. Various perforators has got different names. Much more important for the vascular surgeons to know. The risk factors in these persons with leg ulcers is, of course, the venous stasis, venous not moving properly, obesity, where a person is not too mobile, his muscles are rather weak, doesn't pump properly, or if there's a leg injury and because of the injury, the person is not able to move about, or if he has been bedridden for a long time and there has been a deep vein thrombosis and the thrombus has healed, while healing, it can destroy the valves, which can lead to, and then there can be factor 5 lead and mutation. First, we'll be discussing about the venous ulcer. As I told you, this venous ulcer will have a surrounding skin which will be hard, which will be because of the lipodermatosclerosis. These veins are surrounded, or the blood vessels are surrounded by a fibrous cuff, which will trap the various growth factors. It is a leukocyte trap. All these things occur, and there is a senescent fibroblast will be there. There is a lot of protein deposited over there. And then there is leakage of fluid. Initially, this leakage of fluid was thought to be because through the interendothelial, but these junctions are found to be very, very tight. So it is believed that it occurs through the endothelial cell itself. There is a transport of fluid into the leg and not through the junction. Then there is, of course, increased amount of mast cells over there. Macrophages get attracted to the site around the vessels. And this mast cell, of course, they degranulate and attract the various other factors into the skin and also results in dermal fibrosis. Leukocytes then migrate into the extracellular spaces and they accumulate around the blood vessels. Now, it was believed that these blood vessels are surrounded by this perivascular cuff, and this cuff acts like a wall. And this wall is the one that prevents the exchange of oxygen and the various nutrition. However, it has been seen that these walls are useful stuff. It is like a tunnel which allows the water to flow and not really an obstruction by itself. The flow of, like what happens, how a tunnel is formed in the mountain. The acidic water percolates down through the cracks and fissures in the mountain through the stones and forms a plumbing system. A natural plumbing system evolves in the leg because of the pressure of the water. Similarly, when the water or the fluid seeps into the skin and there is hardening because of the deposition of protein, there is a plumbing that is going on which protects the blood vessels from getting compressed. So it is a natural defense mechanism as in a tunnel. And this extracellular matrix, which is the one that is there, it has got a collagen. As I told you, the cuff does not cut off nutrition. In fact, this cuff, which we see the hard skin over there, is an effort by the skin to maintain the vascular architecture in the affected area. Now, varicose vein accounts for about, if you see, a lot of people will have varicose vein. Not all of them are going to develop ulcers. Few of them will develop edema because of the leakage of fluid. Some of them will develop skin changes over a period of time, and a very small percentage will develop active ulceration. This can be classified using the SEEP classification, where based on the clinical signs, the etiologic classification, the anatomic distribution, and the pathophysiological distribution. SEEP, the first three are not associated, first three grades are not associated with skin changes. From the fourth one, when the skin changes start, that is when the patient start coming to us. And then five, if the ulcer has been formed and it has healed and the person has been treated with, but then inevitable as fact, remorseless as truth, the ulcers most often does recur and many of them will develop ulcer once again over a period of time. There is a severity score which can be based on pain, edema, varicose vein, pigmentation and induration. This is important when you're treating the person for follow-up. It can be on a 10-point scale. Venous ulcers can often be associated, I told you, with deep vein thrombosis. When deep vein thrombosis is there, especially one, it can block the flow. And when there is a flow blockage of flow, there'll be a back pressure. When there'll be a back pressure, the perforators will dilate because of the back pressure. They will permit much more flow. And there will not be proper drainage from the superficial vessels to the deep vessels that will lead to dilatation of the superficial vessels. Superficial vessel thrombosis can be there, wherein there will not be proper drainage through the superficial vessels and the veins will dilate over there and cause the stasis and the dermatitis, leading to venous insufficiency. When these changes have been for a long time and there is a leakage of fluid, this fluid, as I told you, gets organized. And when it gets organized, we get these changes which we call as lipodermatosclerosis, which also to some extent impairs the lymphatic drainage of the place, leading to further swelling. Obesity, of course, adds to the problem. And ankle joint, if there is ankylosis of the ankle joint, obviously the muscle pump cannot work. Like we have two pumps in our body. One is that of the heart and other is that on the leg. The heart pumps it to the periphery and the leg pumps it up back into the heart. Now that we have discussed about how the venous ulcers get formed because of inadequate drainage of the venous system, flow is okay, but drainage does not occur. However, when flow gets compromised, we get arterial ulcer. So how will the flow get compromised? There can be narrowing. And how can narrowing occurs? Because of the deposition of the cholesterol and healing, all those. Or if there is a vasospastic disease, wherein like Raynaud's or some such condition, where the vessels go into spasm, in scleroderma or such condition can go into spasm, and that can lead to the ulcers. This is important to diagnose that it is a vascular ulcer. Up to 50, even if there is 50, the blood will manage its way to push it through. But then when the ankle systolic ankle pressure goes to the 50, then ulcers may occur. But we can classify it as that, for example, if you see trophic changes, that is because of lack of nutrition on the skin. And even if it is 70, we can call it. So if it is 70 with trophic changes, then we call it as arterial ulcer. Or if there are no such this thing, and if it is 50, the systolic ankle pressure, then we can consider that ulcer to be of arterial origin. Arterial ulcers, just as the venous ulcers have got risk factors, arterial ulcers also have the risk factors. Age is a factor. Smoking, you know, can lead to various complications. The flow can be affected. In diabetes, because of deposition of the glycoproteins over there, we can get narrowing of the blood vessels. The nerves are affected. The nerve supply to those areas, the dilatation, all those various things. The diabetes, of course, is a very complicated thing and can lead to numerous ways by which it can cause ulceration. Then, of course, seems to be more common in men, probably because they do a lot of standing work and sedentary lifestyle where a person is not very active. In those persons, we can get arterial ulcer. Diabetes, as I told you, it's coming once again. Then increased lipids can get atherosclerosis can occur, and atherosclerosis can lead to the hypertension by itself, there will be more amount of peripheral vascular resistance. And when there is peripheral vascular resistance, it can act. Hypertension can cause arterial ulcer by itself, or it can add to the arterial ulcer. So important thing is to differentiate between the venous ulcer and the arterial ulcer. Venous occurs in the lower portion of the legs, more often over the medial portion of the legs, whereas arterial ulcer can occur almost anywhere, but more often on the lower legs and dorsal of the feet is where arterial ulcer. Arterial ulcers are relatively more painful and venous ulcers are slightly less painful. Tenderness also arterial. Naturally, when we raise the leg, the blood supply is compromised, and so the ulcer, arterial ulcers, become more painful. There'll be pallor, draining of what little blood is flowing over there gets drained over there, and because of the lack of nutrition over there, the skin will become shiny, and there'll be loss of hair. And lack of nutrition also can lead to changes over the nails. So this is the various place you can see where we can get the arterial ulcers. Apart from this, hypertension can be de novo a factor by itself. We call them as hypertensive ulcers. Somewhat difficult on occasions to distinguish it from arterial ulcers. But then here the cholesterol level might be normal. And the thing is, in hypertension, you will find that the blood pressure also is likely to be normal in these cases. What happens when a person is very conscientious and regular and takes antihypertensive this thing regularly, the more important organs such as the brain, the heart, they are well protected. Whereas the other ulcers, the leg is the one which is much more affected. So the BP might be well controlled. The macrovascular complications because of the brain and the heart does not occur if the person is on regular treatment. His BP will be normal. But the long-standing ulcer, because of the narrowing and the reduced blood supply of the peripheral constriction of the vessels, can lead to ulcers over the leg, which we call as hypertensive ulcers. And these are awfully painful. It will get very difficult to differentiate from conditions like calciphylaxis. Now, one of the most important thing in the manufacture of, in the maintenance or of the leg ulcer is the blood pressure. The pressure bandage which we give in these persons, the compression bandage which we give in the management. So for doing that, we cannot go about applying the compression bandage to all the persons who come, because the compression bandage itself can give rise to ulcer. So we have to maintain pressure, find out the ankle brachial pressure index of the person. Now what is this? We have to find out if there is adequate perfusion from the artery. If there is not adequate perfusion from the artery, and if we put a compression, we'll further compromise the arterial supply. So we'll have to find out what is the ankle brachial index. For that, we measure the highest systolic ankle pressure and then the systolic ankle pressure at the brachial area by using a regular blood pressure equipment. This we measure with the Doppler. And if this index is between 0.8 to 1.2, that means there is a good arterial flow in this area. So in this, if you compress, the pressure from the R is such that it will push past your compression so that arterial blood will reach the leg. Whereas the vein is the one which, when compressed, the blood will flow up, will not compress the, will permit, because we are going to give compression in such a way that pressure is going to be more in the lower down area. And as we go up, the pressure will be less. So from a low pressure area, we'll push the blood up into a, from a high pressure area, we'll push the blood up into a low pressure area. So that in vein will not get, will improve, whereas arterial supply will continue. Whereas if the arterial blood supply, if arterial insufficiency is there, and this index comes less than 0.8, that means the arterial blood supply to the leg is compromised. In these conditions, if you put a compression bandage, as I told you, we are going to further compromise on the arterial blood supply and give rise, lead to worsening of the ulcer, because one, the ulcer can be because of the arterial. Two, it can be mixed where the both venous and arterial factors can be there. However, just because this index is normal doesn't mean that we can. In certain cases, the arteries cannot be compressed. In those places where the artery cannot be compressed because of atherosclerosis, we will find that the index will be normal. So we'll have to find out if there is arterial calcification. If calcification is there, this index does not carry much meaning. Then of course, if there is an ulcer, there can occur infection. And when infection can occur, there can be pain because of the colony, because of secondary infection over there. So we'll have to do a culture in this. Superficial, taking a swab is not enough. We have to do a biopsy take a tissue and send the tissue for culture. The other investigations which we do is aimed at trying to find out what are the contributory factors, like what is the blood sugar, what is the albumin, if the person has got hypoalbuminemia for various reasons, whatever reason, then more amount of fluid is likely to flow out and correction of hypoalbuminemia becomes important. Then other investigations we find out, try to find out if patient has got any collagen vascular disease, rheumatoid factor or any other thing, ANCA, which can also lead to ulcers. Lupus anticoagulant, anticardiolipin are important in selected cases wherein we find that a person is having ulcers which are painful. He might be having a collagen vascular disorder, and in those persons, especially ladies, there can be history of abortion or case of stroke. In those cases, we'll have to do a lupus anticoagulant and anticardiolipin, beta 2 glycoprotein, to find out if he has got. In those cases, of course, if that is there, the treatment becomes different. But I'm not going to discuss that in depth over here. Then we'll have to do a coagulation profile in these cases, find out if there is increased tendency for coagulation, wherein the thrombus can form, and the resolution of the thrombus, as I told you, can lead to destruction of the valves in the vein. Then what happens when there is a leg ulcer? People don't respect the leg as much as they respect the other parts of the body. When there is a pain or ulcer, they just apply whatever is applied, whatever is available, and they think it is only an application. So these people who have got a stasis ulcer, stasis dermatitis, before they come to you, they would have tried lot of preparation, lot of neomycin, soframycin, framycin, what not. And this is a package deal. When you apply a cream or an ointment, it does not contain the main ingredients alone. It has got preservatives, it has got antibiotics, it has got antimicrobials, so many things apart from the main one. So any of these can cause sensitivity. Leg ulcer, especially venous leg ulcer, is one condition wherein we can get multiple positivity. And any other person who gets multiple positivity, in those persons, we are going to suspect whether they've got irritable back syndrome or angry back syndrome or irritable skin. Whereas in case of leg ulcers, these persons can have multiple sensitivity and all of them are true sensitivity. And we have conducted studies, Dr. Balachandran, me and Dr. Jaj Manipal. And we did patch testing with the leg ulcer series. It's a huge series for the leg ulcer, various topical this thing. And then we tried to correlate whether the person is sensitive to any of these. And we found that these are the various causes, this thing. Chlorcresol is a preservative, antiseptics, antibiotics, all these can cause sensitivity. Then we wanted to find out, though of course we always tell in the case of leg ulcer, we try to avoid topicals. We wanted to find out whether the allergic contact dermatitis in leg ulcer can delay wound healing. So we conducted certain experiments in the animals wherein we created a wound, and then we also first we initiated a dermatitis. After sensitizing the animal, initiating dermatitis, we made a wound to see if there is a delay in the wound healing, and we found that in a short term, there was no delay. However, this was done over a period of within 15-20 days, the dermatitis wound, how much amount of healing with dermatitis, without dermatitis, and there was no significant difference. However, we have not done a study to see if there is a long-standing dermatitis in these cases and whether that is going to create. My guess is yes, it will make a difference if we have a long-standing dermatitis, but we don't have data for that. We did the patch testing, as I told you, with the leg ulcer series obtained from Chemotechnic Lab. These are the various chambers which we used, and this is some of the positives which we got. This is in another study done by Rina, not the previous one, which we had done subsequently. Once again, we conducted the study and we found that numerous things can cause the allergy. Then, of course, we come to the management of leg ulcers. Certain aspects are common in case of management of leg ulcers, like we have to ensure nutrition, we have to ensure that the person does exercise. Exercise is very, very important. The movement of the leg, sitting can cause ulcer, lying down can lead to DVT. It is the walking that is the most important thing. When we walk, the muscles compress. When the muscles constrict and they compress, they press on the deep veins and they push up. As I told you, when they compress, if there is a defect, if the valve is not there preventing the flow upwards, there is going to be a flow downwards and sidewards into the with superficial vessels which are there in the leg. So exercises and compression, exercises without compression will lead to aggravation of the ulcers. So you have to give a compression bandage and then advise exercise. Otherwise, you are going to worsen the venous disc. Of course, elevation always helps. And then another way to promote the drainage is exercise, is to do breathing exercise, pranayama. When you do pranayama or we do breathing exercise or you hold your hand like this, there is a negative pressure over here, and when there is a negative pressure over here, there is an increased movement of blood into the heart, right side of the heart. And of course, we have to see that the leg skin does not become dry. If it becomes dry, so we use emollients over the leg. Treatment of the ulcers, when the person comes to us, they will have ulcers. Cleaning is by far the most important thing, getting rid of the bacterial load. We do not advocate any antiseptics. We do not encourage even potassium permanganate, because potassium permanganate, however carefully we explain to them as to how to use, after 2 or 3 days, the person becomes careless, they use higher strength. So saline is by far the best, and that can be made at home, 2 glasses of water, 1 teaspoon of salt, with the head decapitated, take as much water. If you take 10 glasses of water, 5 spoons of salt, 20 glass, 10 spoons. Boil it well, cool it completely, and use that for compresses. Cheapest and a very effective way to cleanse the wounds. Then of course, there is always a foul smell associated. So at that time I was interested, we were doing some study with activated charcoal, which we have published for reducing the smell in pemphigus. This foul smell which we get in these chronic wounds or burns or pemphigus is because of the liberation of the thiol group of chemical. When the protein gets putrefied, this thiol group of chemical get liberated, and that is responsible for the smell. So we can absorb this chemical using activated charcoal. So if you take activated charcoal, put it in the cotton, and then after dressing, we put a layer of activated charcoal and then do the dressing, you'll find that the smell decreases very significantly. And we published this with Swarna Kumar, myself, and Alarai. Then, of course, having a swim is great fun. And I was trying to look for this thing with Madhubala in the swimming pool. But then I found Nutan, and I thought, she's one of my favorites too on the swimming pool. But more interesting, more reason as to why I'm showing the swimming pool is not to discuss the old Hindi films, but to tell about this great person, Conrad Jobst. Now, he was an engineer, and what he found, that as a young mechanical engineer, he found that he had a venous insufficiency. And because of his venous insufficiency, he was very much slow. He was not able to run properly. He was delayed. But then in water, he was in his elements. In water, while swimming, he was very, very comfortable. He also found that while swimming, the swelling of the leg came down, and that made him wonder why. Then he realized that there is a compression that is going on. And what is this compression? Naturally, at the lower portion of the swimming pool, there is likely to be more pressure because there is more body of water above. As we go up, the pressure is going to go on decreasing. So there is a graded pressure wherein there is much more lower down and much less higher. And this engineer, he recognized this fact and came up with the compression bandage. And once he started using the compression bandage, he was comfortable, and then he marketed that. So this compression bandage, as I told you, before we apply the compression bandage, not all patients are for compression bandage. Before we apply the compression bandage, we should do the ankle brachial index, and then only we should address the compression, prescribe the compression bandage. There is a gradual compression which has to be used in these persons. Lower down, we give a higher amount of compression. And as we go up, the compression decreases. So when there is a pressure and when the muscles contract and we have a compression bandage, then the muscle cannot expand outside. If the muscle cannot expand outside, then that pressure muscle has to constrict inside, and that pressure is transmitted to the deep vein and it is pushed out. Whereas if you don't have a bandage, the muscle is going to stretch outside. And when the muscle is going to stretch outside, there is going to be more amount of stasis. That is the reason why the bandaging is important. If a person comes and immediately we start giving him this compression stockings, then if the edema goes down, the stocking is likely to get loose. So we have to first compress, drain whatever edema is there possible, and then go for the compression stocking because they are quite expensive. So we can use a light stretch supporting crepe bandage, which we can apply from lower down to the higher up. It has got a limited elasticity. Use it for 2 or 3 days. When it remains constantly stretched, the elasticity goes off. Also, it is very important to tell the patient that while drying it before reusing, because sometimes they're oozing, after washing it, they should dry it horizontally and not vertically, because of the water, weight of the water would constantly stretch and further elasticity, and it will just will be lost, and it will be just as good as any long piece of clothing. So in that case, we'll have to be careful that we use a dry it horizontally. But the most effective is a multi-layered bandage, and if any place which prides itself for taking care of leg ulcers, as I have seen in Professor Ryan's clinic in hospital when he was there in Oxford, there is a leg ulcer clinic, and there they used to have this 4-layered compression bandage. I'll be coming to the compression bandage. This is the stockings, which can be class 1, class 2, class 3, depending on the degree of the varicosity. Class 3 is maximum, gives the maximum compression, and for light support, we can go for it. The more compression we give, the less comfortable the stocking is. It can be below knee, it can be above knee. But whenever you give above knee, you'll find that many patients do not use it. So even though above knee will give a better result, the below knee is the one that is more practical for the use of the persons. So this is the 4-layer compression bandage which I have been telling about. By far the best way to compress when a person comes initially after doing the ankle brachial index, we go in for this. First is a layer of wool which is going to absorb the various material that is getting secreted or getting oozing out from the ulcers. Then we are going to put a crepe bandage, the same as the crepe bandage which I showed over there. Then there is a lightweight elastic compression bandage. It's slightly elastic, that it maintains a pressure over there because of the elasticity. As I told you, crepe can only give compression for some time and then the elasticity goes off. This will ensure that the elasticity compression is maintained. And then lastly, there is a cohesive compression bandage which retains the whole thing in place. So this is a layer which is showing the last layer. We are demonstrating how it is applied on the leg. Then sometimes, like, different persons will require different measures. So in some persons, you will find that in spite of all this, the ulcer does not heal. So in those persons, we can attempt what is known as a vacuum-assisted closure. Now, what is this? This provides a moist environment by using vacuum. That means we are going to suck. Otherwise, how are you going to vacuum? You're going to apply negative pressure. So the exudate gets removed because of the negative pressure. The compression will reduce the edema. The compression will approximate the wound margin together. And this compression, which you are going to give alternatively on and off, is going to be like a pump over there so that the blood will be pushed out and blood, so increasing the blood supply, increase the angiogenesis in that area, and the angiogenesis will lead to better granulation. So here is a pictorial description of what is happening. You can see that there is a suction over there, and there is an ulcer, and how the interstitial fluid is getting formed over there, and how the granulation tissue is there. And because of the removal of the exudate, the bacterial load also decreases. It does not get food. So, and then enhanced blood supply occurs because of the suction pump. And this, of course, can be used in various conditions. I'm going to tell you now how the suction can be done in practice. There are certain equipments available in the market. They're expensive, but with what is available with us, we can do this. And this was demonstrated to us by Pradeep Balasubramanian, who was with us in our department. And he's the one who demonstrated this to us. So we take a sponge form. We can take any plastic network, which comes as a packing material. We can cut that. We can first put that, then take this foam. Then we keep this over the ulcer. Cut it according to the size, cut the foam to size of the ulcer, a little larger than the ulcer. Then we make a hole in that foam for permitting the tube. Then we take a drape, the adhesive drape, which we keep it on the foam and then pass the whole tube through the drape. So this is the one making a hole through the drape for the tube. And then we place the foam, keep it all over there, stick it onto the leg, remove the sticker, the paper portion on the top, which has been keeping it, and this adheres to the leg, seals with the self-adhesive tape. And this is connected to the suction equipment. And we can see that we can maintain a negative pressure of 125. So we apply to 125 and then release it. Apply, bring it to 125, release it not completely, release it partially. So when we do that, then we can find that the gauze goes up and down, the wound keeps shrinking and expanding. And this can be done over a period of time. You can see how it has shrunk over there, how we are releasing the pressure, collapsing. And this is the healing of the wound, which of course occurs slowly over a period of time. Then of course, sometimes we do a Unna's boot. The good old Unna's boot can be used. It is we use zinc oxide and glycerin on a tape which we apply. And the advantage of this is that zinc is necessary for wound healing. This does not adhere to the wound and promote the wound healing. On this, we can apply the crepe bandage for pressure. So this is how we do the Unna's boot application. Then of course, the various dressings available, thousands of dressings are available, but none of them are perfect. None of them are 100%. The one which we use most common over is the hydrocolloid dressing, a semi-occlusive dressing. Now we all know that wound requires a wet atmosphere. And the advantage of this hydrocolloid dressing is it will not stick to the wound, but will stick to the skin. So we take a hydrocolloid dressing, which is larger than that of the ulcer, and we stick it on the ulcer. And so that the center portion is on the ulcer and the hydrocolloid dressing adheres to the surrounding skin. This is a very good absorbent, so it will absorb the moisture. And it will not allow the oxygen to enter, so carbon dioxide tension will go up. And when there is a carbon dioxide tension going up over there, carbon dioxide will promote neoangiogenesis. So when the neoangiogenesis, the granulation tissue starts forming in these cases. So you apply the ulcer and leave it there for about 2 to 3 days. If the ulcer is very small, you can cut it into smaller pieces and then stick it. Sometimes you may require window dressing to support on the fourth side to prevent it from coming back, especially on the fourth, fifth day. If you find that there is too much amount of secretion, you can release it, permit the secretion to come back, and once again place the same ulcer back. And then when you take out the ulcer, you will find that it looks much more bad than how we began with. But after some time, when the edema comes down, you will find that the ulcer has started healing. One may have to change the dressing 2 to 3 times. Each dressing can stay on for a period of 4 to 5 days, depending on the degree of exudation which happens in the ulcer. This is the hydrocolloid dressing. We can also use other materials like calcium alginate, silver sheet, so many are there. Nano silver, so many are there. Then sometimes, if there is too much amount of necrotic material or keratotic material, you will have to do a debridement of it. This debridement can be done mechanically by using a curette or a scalpel. Many of these ulcers are not very painful. However, injection of xylocaine in these cases is not going to reduce the pain because of the high acidic media in that place. You'll find that it becomes hardly effective, the injections, to reduce the amount of pain. So one can go ahead, there will be minimal pain, and one can debride the ulcer. We can also debride the ulcer by enzymatic collagenase is available in the market. We can use that. Alternatively, Saline taught us a simple trick wherein we can take papaya and the raw papaya, and if you nick it, the secretion from that will have pepane, and that is a good enzymatic. And that, if you can put it on a gauze piece and then skip it on the ulcer, there will be enzymatic debridement of the ulcer. And then on cleaning with saline, you will get a much cleaner wound. Infections, we need, as I told you, has to be treated with suitable antibiotics, culture sensitivity, preferably of the tissue, regular dressing. Topical antibiotics are best avoided because of the fear of dermatitis. Ideal dressing, there is nothing known as ideal. No motorbike is going to give 80 kilometers. It is all in ideal condition. Likewise, no dressing is going to be ideal in this bike, in this condition. So, but these are the various demands we make from these dressings. So it should be non-adherent. No single material is going to provide all these ideal conditions. Topical antiseptics are best avoided, though occasionally one can use hydrogen peroxide. Then for reducing mal odor, we can use acetic acid or we can use potassium permanganate. It can reduce the mal odor. Potassium permanganate should be very, very, very dilute. The water should be, the solution should be as dilute as the pink at the nail or the inner aspect of the rose petal. It should be that dilute, 1 in 10,000 concentration, then only we can achieve that concentration. But as I told you, patients do not follow the regulation. After some time, they will just take some potassium permanganate, drop it into a glass of water, and then start cleaning, and that can lead to burns. So use saline, you will be far better off. Then growth factors are available. We can have the platelet-derived growth factors. Various preparations are also available in the market to stimulate, and we can also inject platelet-derived growth factor, which is now tried in many places. Again, these studies were conducted in our department. Dr. Reena, who was the in charge of the SIG or the leg ulcer for the Indian Association of, I think while I was the president, she was the SIG chief in that, and she had conducted these studies both on allergic contact dermatitis and also the platelet-rich plasma injection. And by injecting the platelet-rich plasma, you are able to, this of course on a leg ulcer, but even the stasis ulcer, you are able to promote healing of the condition, but not a very dramatic thing. It adds to the effectiveness of the treatment. Here's another one. So by about a month, you are able to heal, make this ulcer heal. Then, of course, one can also use platelet-rich fibrin, which is a little less cumbersome than PRP. And this can be cut into small pieces and can be kept on the ulcer to promote the healing. PRF. Skin grafting is another way we can do. We can do a complete skin grafting. But then I try to discourage complete skin grafting. The reason being, sometimes if it is lost, the whole skin is lost, then the ulcer remains open. So it is better to go in for tiny pieces of skin. Punch grafting or pinch grafting is a better option, wherein even if you lose some, the others will take up. And sometimes after you do the graft, you will find, when you open, you will find that the whole skin is gone off. The ulcer looks as it was, but that is not true. Only the epidermis would be lost. The dermis will be there, and dermis will once again generate the epidermis. So soon you will find islands of epidermis occurring within this ulcer, which will cover the ulcer and lead to healing of the ulcer. The other drugs which we can give is the calcium deoxycholate, which can increase the nitric oxide level and promote increase, leading to vasodilatation and increased flow. Pentoxifilin, unfortunately, not available now. It has also got anti-inflammatory action. It increases the blood flow by increasing the deformability of the RBC, and was quite popular when we had it. I found it quite effective. Unfortunately, not available now. I do not know why. Aspirin, of course, we know that it can increase the blood flow. Stanozolol is a drug available as Menabol, which we use over there. We can use 2 milligrams twice daily, and this reduces the lipodermatosclerosis in the patients. Like, proper studies, controlled studies have not proved it to be effective. But in practice, I find that the lipodermatosclerosis resolves with the use of stanozolol. But you will have to wait for 3 to 4 months to see the results in these cases. and you'll have to monitor both the blood pressure. In these cases, because many will be already hypertensive, you'll have to monitor that and the liver function test. Zinc, of course, promotes wound healing. We have been told it does. You cannot see it doing much, but probably it helps in the wound healing. So, as I have been discussing, leg ulcer is a rather complicated thing. Vascular surgeon, of course, is going to look at a leg ulcer in a different way. General surgeon is going to have his own viewpoint. As dermatologists, we also have our individual viewpoint. But then on occasions, on many occasions, it is better that all of us should discuss and try to do what is best for the patient. But unfortunately, whatever you do, however much we do it, these ulcers do have a tendency to recur. So many a surgeon, many a physician will meet his Waterloo while managing the leg ulcer. So we cannot send them away. So what we find is that one treatment has failed. So now again, you start off another line of management and see if you can. So patient keeps coming to us and we start trying one thing to other, hoping that eventually everything will go.